Welcome, everybody. My name is Cliff Petrak. I'm from Chicago's Brother Rice High School, at least not anymore. I'm retired now, but I taught there for 40 years, and we've had a lot of our students come to Eastern, I know. I don't think we have any grads here. Certainly not the girls, because we're an all-boys school. But no, we don't have any Brother Rice alums here, huh? Okay. Well, where shall we begin? Don't slow me down with that calculator. When I was about 17 years old, 1 week away from my 18th birthday, just about ready to start at DePaul University to major in math, I was pretty certain I wanted to teach, but that's about as far as my expectations went at that time. But I got a birthday present, and it was a book called The Trachtenberg Speed System of Basic Mathematics. It had been published in 1960, which was the current time. And I read that book, and I just couldn't believe what I had read. And when I got to the end, I did two things. The first thing I did was to pick my jaw up off the floor, because that's how far it had dropped, in amazement of what I had read. And secondly, I went back to page one and started reading through the book again, nice and slowly, trying to really take in a lot of the things that I had learned. Now, since that time, there have been other books written. But that was the start for me, and I know that if I hadn't read that book, I still would have become a math teacher, but I doubt if I would have been in front of you today speaking on speed math. It's become a real passion for me, you might say. I've had a chance to speak in about 17 different states in Canada, and I just enjoy it. So, couple questions or thoughts might come to mind when you see the little logo that I use there. First of all, don't slow me down with that calculator. It sort of sounds as if I'm not too happy about calculators. Not quite true. Calculators serve very important purposes in mathematics, such as finding logarithms or trigonometric values of functions, or finding a very large power of a number. That calculator can really help you out, especially if it's a scientific calculator. But insofar as everyday computations dealing with 2-3-digit numbers, no, they're just too slow. Not only are they too slow, but if they really made us into better math students, think about it. Does that also mean that using an audio book makes us into a better reader? I don't think so. Or how about when we type a letter to a friend of ours on a keyboard? Using that keyboard, does it give us a better handwriting? Nope. Same way with using a calculator. Sometimes it can be convenient, but it doesn't make us into a better math student. So I'm not crazy about the calculator at all insofar as calculations go. But for that matter, I'm also very much against the old-fashioned algorithms that we all grew up with. You see, in 1960, when that Trachtenberg Speed System of Basic Mathematics book came out, I had no idea at the time how big a hit it was going to be overseas. The Europeans and the Asians really picked up on it, and they started to incorporate a lot of the ideas and shortcuts in Trachtenberg's book into their own curriculum and into their own elementary math series. We didn't. What we did instead is we said, oh, look at this other thing that's happening here. A handheld calculator. Hey, isn't that kind of neat? I bet our students would like that. Well, soon we all realized that that was not the answer. But unfortunately, the Europeans and the Asians really moved ahead on this thing. So much so that, I don't know if you're aware of this, but every year in this world, in a different country or a different city, there is a competition held for eighth graders. Each country, if they like, can choose to submit a team of about 10 or 12 eighth graders, along with a team of coaches that have prepared them, for a mental math exam. Obviously, it's timed, but you cannot use any scrap paper. Once you put down an answer, you cannot erase it or change anything. Everything has to be done mentally. Now, here's the interesting thing. In the last competition that was held, the team that finished in first place was the team from Singapore. In second place was the team from South Korea. Third place Japan. Fourth place, Hong Kong. The first four place finishers were all Asian countries. Finally, number five was Belgium. Six was Czechoslovakia. Right behind Czechoslovakia was Slovakia. In eighth place was Switzerland, ninth was Slovenia, and 10th was the Netherlands. Now, of course, you're sitting there saying, well, yeah, wait a second, I didn't hear the US of A, you know. Where did we finish? We finished in 28th place. 28th. Somebody asked me the other day, well, how many teams competed? Well, I don't care if there were 28, I don't care if there were 100. I still wouldn't be happy. In our country, finishing 28th, but here's why it happens. It happens because of what I just told you. These kids from these Asian and some of these European countries are brought up with speed math incorporated into their curriculum in their elementary schools. With our kids, the kids that we submit for the competition, what we do is we try to identify the best students maybe around eighth grade and say, hey, you know, I think you'd be great for that competition. Tell you what, our coaches will work with you for the next 2 years. We'll try to prepare you. And the students do try to learn as best they can for 2 years, but they're up against students that have been learning these shortcut methods from grade one. So that's the problem. So I don't see any improvement soon, unless you do your homework. Your homework is, as I think most of you are future math teachers, your homework is to make a gazillion dollars by going out and writing a complete textbook series for elementary schools incorporating speed math methods. Now, on the other hand, if you're going to fluff off on this homework assignment of yours and you're not going to do it, well, then you're going to have to do the next best thing. And that is, you are going to have to learn as many of these shortcuts as possible, certainly for your own good, which you're going to be able to make use of in the classroom. I guarantee you, you'll be able to make use of them. But, you know, when you first start making use of them in the classroom, if you don't tell the students that these are shortcut methods, they're going to think you're a genius. But after a while, you're not going to be able to keep it into yourself. You're going to have to let it out, and you're going to have to tell your students, hey, here's how I was able to get the answer so quickly. I did this and this and this and this. And they're going to love it. For kids that are above average, for them, it's the next level up. It's the level they've been looking for. For the slower kids, it gives them a reason for memorizing their multiplication tables and their other number facts. Because they can learn, once they know that, they can use these shortcut methods to make themselves produce answers quicker than the average student. So let me mention then, before I forget, that at the end of today's session, I've got a handout for everybody. And I've also got one of these coupons for everybody for your CPDUs. So make sure you take one of these and one of these. We don't need to hand out, however, in getting through this session right now for this hour. So I'll have them up here, and you can pick them up later. Now, let me also mention quickly that if we had enough time, I would talk about shortcuts in addition, subtraction, fractions, squaring, and multiplication. As you know, I'm just handling squaring and multiplication in this hour. And even there, I have to leave out tons of good stuff. Again, with unlimited amount of time, I would be able to present to you 52 shortcut methods. That's how many I've mastered so far, 52. In your handout, I detail 9 of those 52 methods. So it's a nice starting point for you, but 9 is nowhere near enough. Sooner or later, someplace, you're going to have to learn the rest of them. Now, you can take notes. Feel free to take notes. But I'll just mention that all 52 of my methods are in this book, Don't Slow Me Down With That Calculator, which I wrote. It's a self-published book, so you cannot get it in a bookstore. However, the back of your handout has an order blank here. I sell them for $15. With the postage, it's $18.75. So if anybody wanted to buy a book and had the money with them, I would recommend just paying the $15. I do have receipts for anybody who needs them, and I can take a check. Enough of the commercial. I think it's the best book in the world insofar as shortcut math techniques are concerned. And again, it includes everything that I'm going to talk about, along with everything that, unfortunately, we won't have time for. Now, that having been said, I think we can get started. And this is good. I'm going to pretty much split the time between squaring and multiplication. And feel free to ask as many questions as you want. Feel free to take notes, although I got to tell you, all 40 of my years in the classroom were on the high school level. I never taught on the elementary level. However, I'm learning what it means to teach on the elementary level because for the past, 5 or 6 years, I've been teaching a course during the summer for students anywhere from grades 3 through 9. They hold it back at the school where I used to teach. And one of the interesting things is when those students come into class, I always ask them the same question at the beginning of class. And after the first session, they get to know the answer pretty well. I say to them, is there anybody here who didn't bring a pen and pencil with them? And when I ask that question with that tone of voice, usually there will be a couple of sheepish hands that go up. And I'll respond with, good job, you're ready for class. And they are, because they're not going to be using pen and pencil to figure out answers. They're going to be using their God-culators. Comes with a lifetime battery. Why not? Seriously, though, I mean, sure, you want to take notes with a pen and pencil, but I want to stay away from that pen and pencil as much as possible. Right now, I'm in sort of a teaching situation, so you will see me doing a little bit of writing, but I think I'll also convince you that we really don't need the pen at all, except now and then to write down an answer that we're looking for. We won't need it for calculating the answer. Okay, now, with our little introduction out of the way, let's get moving. Here's why we're here. U.S. lags industrial world in math. American students below average in every category, including in every specific area tested, from geometry and algebra to statistics and computation, whether it's addition, multiplication, squaring, fractions, whatever. We've got to do something about that. So you might say, well, wait a second, what do you mean do something about it? What can we do? Kids don't compute very well, don't calculate very well, they want to run for the calculators. I don't allow them to use it. Well, yeah, okay, fine, you don't allow them to use it. What's happening in the meantime, though? They're not learning. Well, let's think about this a little bit. If we're doing a problem, I don't care if we're trying to add 2 plus 2 or we're doing something far more advanced, what's our objective? Well, everybody's going to say the same thing. Oh, my objective, I want to get the right answer. You're absolutely right. That should be the objective number one. But we should have 3 more objectives in addition to that one, and here they are. We should also try to get the problem done in a minimum amount of time. We shouldn't be working on a problem all period long unless it's really a tough problem that's going to take the whole period. Let's get through the problem as quickly as possible. And let's try to do that, obviously, with a minimum amount of writing, preferably just the answer. In other words, when I say just the answer, I mean, for example, if we're multiplying 2 numbers, we don't want to write one number under the other and then go through all this multiplication. Because after all, what are you saying to the kids? Or what will you be saying when you get into the classroom with the kids? You're going to say, kids, no calculators in my class. Uh-uh. I don't allow that. So what are you telling the kids to do? You're telling them that when they multiply 31 times 33, they got to put the 31 there, the 33 here, draw the line, do the 4 multiplications, add up the columns to get 1,023. We don't want that. We want just the answer. We want them to just write 1023 as the answer. And wouldn't it be nice if they can give this answer, as I just did, orally, without paper and pencil, without even sometimes finding it necessary to see the problem visually in front of them? I'm going to show you how we can do some of that.